Down with the patriarchy, many call today. It's time for new leadership. And I agree. To some extent, the patriarchy has descended into the hands of weak and petty con men, who are but the puppets of corporate interest and banking cartels. Poor leaders in the past, and even today, have caused genocides, famines, and untold harm to humanity. But I don't think the patriarchy is the problem. Patriarchy only means a father is the head of the home or nation. And I would argue this is natural. Masculinity leads. Femininity deepens and amplifies. Mature masculine men, in union with the feminine, make the best leaders. Ooh, I know the triggers are going off, but please hear me out before you bark your reply. This is a sensitive subject and we got some nuance to cover. First off, I'm not talking about the weak and stunted masculinity that you are accustomed to in the modern world. I'm talking about the mature masculinity of the loving father and heroic warrior.
Let us together rebuild this world, that we may share in the days of peace.
Society, in its natural state, orbits around the man of exceptional quality and strength, especially in troubled times. This was the norm across the vast majority of the classical and indigenous world. In nature, fathers lead. They lead, protect, and nourish their families and communities. That is the essence of patriarchy. Now, before you come at me with your examples of strong woman leaders and matriarchal elephants, let me explain further. I'm not saying every man needs to be masculine or woman feminine, nor that every man is a good leader. Women can lead too, and some do it well. But most of the time, it's women who are acting out their masculine side, which can be exhausting for many. The feminine has a different role other than direct leadership, which is just as important, if not more, than the masculine role, and we will get there. For now, realize I'm not trying to put women down in any way. In fact, I'm trying to save the feminine that is left in the world, and that is done through patriarchy. We don't need to remove the father figure and masculine leader. We need to revive him and bring up our sons to be great fathers and leaders again. Unfortunately, today we attack things before we understand them. Masculinity is a prime example. In the rush for progress and liberation, people are destroying the one thing that protects society from tyrants and leads to safety and freedom. Here, I want to shed some light on masculinity versus femininity and corrupt leadership versus natural leadership. This is my opinion. I welcome you to make your own video if you want to debate me. So let's begin at the triggering point, and then I'll support the argument. Truly masculine men tend to be the best leaders because they are the most secure. Biologically, personally, socially, and financially, masculinity is designed to create order and security through its confrontation with challenge. The main heroes in popular movies like Star Wars, The Hobbit, and Batman illustrate this masculine journey perfectly. Bruce Wayne of Batman Begins was initiated into manhood through losing his parents, grappling with loss, leaving everyone he knew behind, and descending into the criminal underworld to fight injustice. He endured the worst hardships, peoples, and prisons, and eventually got inducted into the League of Shadows. This was formative for him. Under expert guidance, he fought, trained, and mastered himself and his fears. All of this intensity fortified his masculinity. He became strong, robust, capable, skilled, and fearless. As a result, he gained the integrity and responsibility to wield power well. He emerged as a highly secure and strong masculine man. And this is the key point. When a man is absolutely secure, life is no longer about him. It's about what value he can offer and provide to others. Great leadership flows outward from initiated men who are in touch with their heart and secure. Inner security alone allows for trust, integrity, and gentleness. And the mark of a truly masculine man is that he fully trusts himself. Let me repeat that. A truly masculine and cultivated man trusts himself because he has been through hell and back and developed supreme strength, courage, and prowess because of it. And these qualities are masculine in the oldest sense of the word. I'm not saying women aren't strong and capable. But you must understand men were measured by their manliness in every culture for all of time. Boys used to be constantly tested by nature, elders, and each other. I have a whole video about the initiations of masculinity, which you can find here. But essentially, boys were exposed to progressive danger, pain, and hardships to make them manly. Manhood was never a given. It was earned when a boy exhibited excellence in war, hunting, and self-command. Manhood, to many indigenous tribes, such as the Native Americans of Iowa, was referred to as the big impossible. Entire cultures were structured to encourage manly achievement because the flourishing of a people is dependent on the quality of its masculine leadership. Men, and especially leaders, must first and foremost be strong and competent if they are to be valuable to anyone. When men are weak, families break and society falls. In the movie The Hobbit, Desolation of Smaug, there is a great example of the corrupting force of weakness seen in the Master of Lake Town. He is a gluttonous and selfish boy who is deeply insecure and ignorant. He is not a man, and far from an exceptional one. The Master of Lake Town brings oppression wherever he goes to maintain control. Many people say power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. But this is wrong. Power does not corrupt. It reveals. It reveals a man's nature, and whether he is noble or weak. Bard, Aragorn, Batman, and many heroes we love demonstrate that power does not corrupt great men, only weak men. And weakness, when enthroned, is the worst tyranny. We see this in the insecure boss, who micromanages employees, secretly sabotages opponents, and constantly has to prove him or herself. We see this in the morally weak father or king, who lashes out in fear and anger. A good leader must first and foremost be absolutely competent and secure, and that is the byproduct of healthy masculinity. Security. A strong man naturally becomes secure and creates order, and because of his manliness, he makes others feel safe and free to flourish. Just think, the only person who can honestly celebrate your greatness without envy is someone secure with the greatness inside themselves. The only leader who can make the unpopular but wise decision is someone who doesn't need the validation of others. The person with the greatest internal strength and security needs the least external control. And all of these scenarios are describing the archetype of the embodied king, the man of exceptional integrity, competence, and security. Most leaders we see today exhibit weak masculinity on almost all fronts. They are selfish instead of community-centered, easily swayed and bought, and often spiteful or manipulative. And worst of all, their insecurity in their own power creates the need to control others. Female leaders are perhaps even more guilty of insecure masculinity, as it is not how they are biologically wired. And when weakness rules, it is the worst tyranny possible. Weakness and insecurity, especially in leadership, is the root of all corruption and evil. An example of this is depicted in the movie Gladiator, which takes place in ancient Rome. Maximus is a good general of Marcus Aurelius. He is strong, committed, courageous, and loyal to his emperor and family. Emperor Aurelius loves him, almost as much as he distrusts his own son, Commodus.
You will not be emperor. My powers will pass to Maximus.
Commodus, being the jealous and weak man that he is, immediately sets out to destroy his rival. He captures Maximus and has his whole family killed. Maximus winds up in the slave pits, fighting as a gladiator with barely the will to live. But he works his way up the ranks until he is fighting in the Colosseum of Rome. Maybe, just maybe, he might get a shot at revenge on the new emperor. Commodus, meanwhile, is destroying Rome. Driven by a relentless desire for power and approval, he starts throwing more and more public games. Commodus's insecurity and thirst for dominance is evident to everyone, and it stands in stark contrast to the quiet strength and honor of Maximus. In the end, Maximus, a lowly gladiator who has won fame, challenges Commodus in the Colosseum, where he knows the emperor cannot say no, and he slays the tyrant. I use this example to contrast unnatural and weak authority with natural leadership. You see, Commodus is the essence of weak and insecure masculinity, and he needs to control everyone because of it. He wants his father and people to love him, but everyone laughs at him. He wants dominance, but when people don't submit, He seeks to crush or manipulate them. He is not respectable and manly, but plain childish, and everyone senses his weak character and personality, so he must compensate constantly. Because he is not an exceptional man and lacks natural authority, he becomes a cruel tyrant, and this is the story across history. Maximus, on the other hand, was a natural general and would have made a fine emperor. People instantly respected him and his masculine prowess and organized under him. Even the slave gladiators on the fighting fields fought for him.
Whatever comes out of these gates, we've got a better chance of survival if we work together. Do you understand?
Men's hidden strength is their ability to instantly collaborate as comrades when exposed to external threat. When attacked by enemies, or in the case of Maximus, thrown into the Colosseum with other men to be massacred, the gladiators naturally banded together under the leadership of the male who possesses the greatest force of personality and vision. The most charismatic, strong, and valiant warriors have always led in the natural order. People orbit around them automatically. They have what some call born leadership, and I would call natural authority or an aristocratic nature. Women can possess this nature too, but it is expressed slightly differently through their elegance, self-assuredness, and mobilization of people. My mom, for instance, organizes massive events and movements like the conductor of an orchestra. Her capacity to bring people towards a vision is unmatched, and I don't know what we'd do without her. But once the party starts, it's my dad who often is giving the speech and leading the charge. You see, they're a team. My dad leads directly, and she initiates and manages from behind. Each circumstance is different for every couple, but understand this. If a woman led in the natural world without a man in front, she would be physically insecure constantly, always needing to prove herself and protect herself. How could she lead the hunts for food, protect the village from attacks, and bear the extreme stress of leadership in the field where other men are jockeying for her position all the time? It's not possible, and almost never existed, no matter how much feminists claim it did. A female leader would be at the mercy of any charismatic warlord who gathered together the young men and wanted power. This is why, historically, old and weak leaders and matriarchs must break down the most energetic warrior youths as to protect their own power. Strong and charismatic young men must be indoctrinated or broken at all costs.
In an ideal world, sire, we'd arrest him. But Bard has the favor of the people. They see him as a leader.
You picked the wrong man to tangle with, Master Bard.
If a promising leader of men does not conform, they are exiled or killed to protect the status quo. We saw this with Socrates of Athens, and in some ways, Andrew Tate today. Though I'm no great fan of his, he did pose a threat to the hierarchy, so he was silenced and ruthlessly attacked. Since a small band of young heroes and revolutionaries could easily overthrow weak and senile regimes, the ruling classes must keep a tight grip on society. In ancient Athens, the old men and demos couldn't let Socrates' anti-democratic ideas infect the next generation, so they killed him. Morally and physically weak people have to carefully control society because they possess no natural authority. This is key. If you lack natural magnetism and leadership, you must rely on control of others. When natural authority is overthrown, tyranny ensues, and it often hides itself as we see today. Just look at the nursing home that is the American government and the governments around the world and tell me I'm wrong. The whole world is ruled by ancient banking families, decrepit old men, and hags who are moving society closer to a dystopic slave state with each year. They must maintain their power through covert means, and the masters of this world play this game perfectly. They break the spirits of men and separate them. They control the narratives, manipulate the masses with propaganda, and make sure people stay docile and sick. I'm not sure how much of it has been orchestrated malintent, but men have been emasculated and isolated. In recent years, we have been taught to despise rugged masculinity and patriarchy. That's because young warriors and loving fathers are the only ones who could actually overthrow the current regime of corruption. They pose the greatest threat. The founding fathers of America, for instance, the revolutionaries who threw off the shackles of imperial reign and started out towards a new vision, were young. A lot of them were under the age of 44. And I highlight this to remind you that most great moments of renewal and ascending life revolved around young men of exceptional quality and personality. Old and weak tyrants seek to suppress vital young men from banding together in brotherhoods. And as natural authority is increasingly subverted and subjected, a surveillance slave state emerges to control the public. So if what you mean when you say down with the patriarchy is down with the weak and corrupt leaders, I totally agree. Down with the old banking families and oligarchs. It's time to break their death grip on society and wake up from our confusion that they sow. Let the young warriors and their queens rise to power once more as nature intended. Hey, I'm Christian, and here we're dedicated to reviving high culture. But I need your help to create something more than a piece of content. So we're starting a community over on School for revolutionary thinkers and leaders. And I'm so excited about this platform. And yes, it's free forever if you join this month. I'll be posting exclusive podcasts and interviews and hosting live Q&As and building a sense of community there. The new renaissance has to begin somewhere. So let's get the party started together. Link in the description to join. Part 2. Manhood and feminine power. Individuals can be whatever they want, and there's no one size fits all. But in the general population, most men are masculine and women feminine, and we should focus on turning out the highest quality of each, rather than hyperfixating on the exceptions to the rule. We need to stop glorifying confusion and get clear on the principles that lead to the highest flourishing in relationships and society. And I would argue that looks like strong masculine men leading, and yet devoted to feminine women who inspire them. That is nature's way, simple and true. Today, we are really fixated on making women powerful, but we go about it by trying to make them more masculine instead of feminine. As a response to the patriarchy, feminism simply perpetuated more masculinity in women's bodies, which I think misses the point entirely. My dad the other day was talking about me, and he told someone I was looking for a strong, independent woman. And I was like, hell no. So he's like, wait, you want a weak and dependent woman? And I'm like, no. I don't value a woman based off how tough and independent she is, but rather how deep, nurturing, and radiant she is. The world is in dire need of true women and true men again, and these polarities can only exist in relationship to each other. A masculine man allows a feminine woman to surrender and flourish, and in turn she deepens his heart. The loss of the feminine is a consequence of the loss of the masculine. Without true masculinity, the feminine is not safe enough to exist. This is the root of all of our problems. Masculinity has become weak, and without it, femininity dies. Because no sane woman with a good heart would follow a man she despises, she must take on the world alone, and hence becomes more masculine. She can't submit to a man who can't lead himself. For all of human history, manhood was never a given, as we explored. It was not a biological consequence. It was something men had to earn against mighty odds and trials of initiation, hunting, and war. And through earning it, he earned the right to lead and the respect of others. A good woman then takes these manly and rugged men who come back from the initiation, and she refines them. She softens the edges and connects them to their hearts and calls them into their most dominant forms. Women, that is, feminine women, inspire men upward and demand excellence of them and offer a counterbalance in perspective. She sees what most men cannot. The radiant and feminine woman has always played the key role as queen, oracle, and indirect counselor of leaders. In ancient Germanic, Greek, and Scythian worlds, the oracle was the most sacred for her wisdom and intuitive heart. And the queen was venerated for her grace and intelligence and organization of people. Kings bowed before them and asked for guidance on the most pressing issues. Radiant women across all of time were what inspired men to be great and noble at home and heroes in war. Hell, women were the catalyst for most wars and artwork and great deeds for all of time. They hold a dangerous power over men, and one that they have mostly forgotten today. You see, the power of the feminine woman is not in outward shows of strength and dominance that Hollywood now forces down our throats. Her strength lies in her heart, in her values, her quick thinking, and her capacity to inspire devotion. The most interesting power of the feminine, though, is that her values and standards create the dominant culture. Whatever women as a whole look for in men, men seek to fulfill. If women desire noble and masculine men, the common man will seek to rise to that position in order to earn a mate. If women desire looks and superficial things, men will stoop to fulfill that request. In many ways, that is the biblical story of Lilith, who was blamed with toppling a whole nation because she subverted the sex icons and encouraged promiscuity with hot men instead of great men, which destroyed the next generation of boys. This is why modesty and selective breeding was so important in far ancient times. Whatever women admired and sought, men became. Hence, the chivalrous knight of France fought for honor and justice and demonstrated his refined character in town, all to earn the favor of the most beautiful maiden. He tried to be whatever she held in her mind. So perhaps chivalry is dead. But don't put that on us men. Women killed it, and women have the power to revive it. Whatever women reward, men will become. Men will try to get mates in any way they can, and intelligent women and cultures have harnessed the male sex drive to produce true masculinity that will help everyone flourish. The woman's gaze directs the course of society. Hey, thanks for watching Wisdom Warriors. So we just covered a lot of ground there. There's a playlist right here where you can watch more videos on masculinity and self-development. Also, there's links in the description below to get my new book and to join the membership community if you want to level up with other men. I'll see you over there. Peace.